Morning everyone, Carol here at Oak House Journals, and as always, big warm welcome from me. Thank you for joining me today. So I'm on week 36 of the 52 Tags Handmade Challenge, and the prompt for this week was slow stitching, although Anne did throw in a couple of other suggestions. She was talking about different densities of fabrics, a neutral pallet, and having a small area for stitching. So there were a couple of suggestions thrown in as well. And if you watch my channel, you'll know that I'm interpreting Anne's prompts not to make tags, but to make things that I will use either in ongoing projects or ones I've got planned. When I heard the neutral palettes, I thought, great, that's my kind of thing for the heirloom journal. These are some handkerchiefs that I found, vintage handkerchiefs that I found and bought. And I also came across this beautiful, beautiful baby's christening gown. It's absolutely lovely. It has seen better days in parts, but just look at the top. So these are the fabrics that I came up with. They're all shades of white or slight off-white. Now, I know Anne said really use different densities of fabrics, which is what I've got here ostensibly, but she said to keep them fairly plain. Well, I'm going to kind of ignore that because that was Anne's suggestion. I love the play of lace with fabric. And I actually thought that I would use one of these lovely indentures that I've got. And I'm going to use just this back portion here, or this back panel. So what I thought I would do would be to do something along the lines of something we've all probably done. And you've certainly, if you've not done it, you've seen it, is to do these little little lace and fabric samples using ribbon crimps. Now, I'm not actually going to use a ribbon crimp, but it's the same principle. And if you look at what these are like, they're just layered up pieces of fabric and lace. It's really, really akin to what Anne has done without the embroidery. So what I thought I would do is actually utilize the same principle with this document rather than the ribbon crimps, using the fabric and then stitch on the top. Now, Anne created for herself a square to stitch. Now, I don't know whether I'm going to actually physically do that or if I'm just going to stitch randomly over my my piece, whatever you'd want to call it. I don't know what it would be, really. I don't know. I will see how things pan out. So anyway, I've talked enough. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to clear all this away and I will be back at the end with a little show and tell. So thanks so much, everybody, and I'll be back soon. So this is where I've got to so far. As you can see, I've layered up all my lace, and I actually did include that lovely, very delicate lace. When I actually put, I couldn't resist not including it. And when I put it on, I really liked how it did the transition for me from the whites through to this ivory, through to the colour on the indenture paper, and only a tiny little bit of that will be showing, as you will see in a moment. So as much as I love doing embroidery, the one stitch I really, really can't do is running stitch. I just can't do it. I can't get my stitches even, and it really frustrates me. I need to practice more, I know I do, and then it would probably come, but I've never been able to do it particularly well. So I've taken this little piece of lace up and I've taken it over the top of my flap, because I think it would give me a nicer finish up there. And then I've done four rows of running stitch up here. If I hold it up to the camera, you can see how pants it is. I'm sorry. But what I do, and I know that that will be hidden, but I'm hitting the prompt that Anne wanted for this week, which was running stitch. I have also done a very, very thin line of running stitch all along the seam of this lace hanky, and what I plan to do now is go back in that direction and maybe do a third row back, and then I'm going to call it finished. So I'm going to crack on and get that done now. What I've done it in is two strands of this Blanc DMC thread, so let's get going. And you'll see what I mean about it's painful for me doing this. It really is. I just really struggle to get my stitches even. So there we have it, everybody. That's my lines of stitching. Sorry if that was painful for you, but I had to go super slow to try and get them as even as possible. And if I just hold them up to the camera, that's the best I could do, I'm afraid. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to take out my pins. Whoops. And I originally did think that, let me just clear these out of the way. I originally thought that what I would do is I would actually sew this piece into this upper piece up here. Let me pull that down a little bit. That's what it'll look like. So what I thought I would originally do is actually stitch that by hand onto the indenture paper, but it is going to be too thick, and I think it would spoil the look that I've tried to achieve, which is really to keep everything as light as possible. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to glue that in place and put my inclusions in. So I'm going to bring in my glue book and treat myself to a new page. And just pop some fabric glue. This is 3-in-1 beacon glue. I was going to say Fabri-Tac then for a minute, but I think they're all basically the same, a much of a muchness. And I've put quite a generous portion up there, but what I like to do to stop seepage is just run it over quickly with my fingers like that. I'm just going to line up the bottom. Let's take it off the glue book. So I'm just going to line up the bottom just being a little bit careful because I'm conscious of where I want this little piece of lace to show through at the top. So I'm just being a little bit cautious there about where I close it. And I'm just going to get my bone folder and just gently encourage it to adhere as I'm holding it. You've got a little bit of wiggle room with Beacon 3-in-1 glue and Fabric Tack, so I'm just taking my time and letting it gently adhere. And there we go, got a little bit peeping through at the side there. Not bothered about that. I'm just going to snip it off and encourage it to fray a little bit more there. I think it might help if I actually put my glasses down, see what I'm doing. And similarly on this side, a little bit of fluff or fraying poking through. I think I will take away, that's the threads from my stitching, so I think I'm going to take that away. And similarly there, this is obviously from my pieces at the back. And there we go, that's my piece. I've just decided I want to include this little fabric covered button that came off the christening gown that gave me this piece of fabric down here, and I just want to pop it up in this corner up here because as you can see I've not cut my lace absolutely perfectly, and I didn't realize until I actually stitched it on that it wasn't right. I mean, I could trim that edge down, but I'm not going to. What I thought I would do is I would just use a little bit of lace out of my scrap pot that lives on the windowsill in front of me and just make a little tiny embellishment in this top corner up here. So I'm just putting a little dab of glue up in that corner. I've just tucked it under the vintage lace there, and then for my button I'm not going to stitch it on, I'm actually going to glue this one on because the fabric is actually coming away from the button, so I've glued it back in place, but I don't think it would take any stitching, to be perfectly honest. That little piece of lace wants to come down a bit more. So there we go. So I've just got that little bit of an embellishment in that top corner, and I'm going to just trim that lace because I don't want it being too prominent. I just want a little bit of detail just there for that. And now I'm going to use a little bit of the ribbon that came from the christening gown just to put a tiny little bit of an embellishment up here. As you could probably see, I couldn't use the ribbon from the christening gown, it was so fragile that if I put any tension on it at all, it was just breaking into pieces, which is such a shame because it was the perfect colour, and I don't have any ribbon in my stash that matches this this shade. So what I ended up doing was using another little offcut, as you can see here, from this ribbon that I have here. It's invaluable, this ribbon. I use it all the time. I get it from a local craft shop, and this is what it looks like, and then it has this going across the top. So I chop it out quite a lot, use the flowers. I also use the bottoms here for embellishment, as you saw with the piece, the button embellishment down below. So I keep every little single scrap of that in this little pot here. So I ended up using a piece of that. I didn't want a mass of fluffy chiffon, sari chiffon, because I think it would have hidden the detail here. I'm not even convinced that this is right. I wanted something more delicate. That's why I wanted that piece of ribbon from the christening gown. But anyway, it is what it is. I chose this because it matches this piece here. So this is my finished piece. I'll just hold it up so that hopefully you can get a better look. As you saw, what I did was underneath all my layers here, there's a little piece of sari chiffon there. There we go, little piece of sari chiffon, then the christening gown, then one of the hankies, then the other hanky. So I have my little piece here, and I've got some little bits of family ephemera that I want to use in this, because this is going in my mum's heirloom journal. So this is a valuation that she had done years and years and years ago on her wedding and engagement ring, and I just think it's lovely to be able to pop that in the back pocket and keep it safe. So that's what that little pocket is for. And then you might have noticed that because I've done some stitching on the reverse of this page, I just put a little piece of lace there, and I've got an old family photo of my mum when she was a child outside her house. And then I've got this little piece of ephemera. This is the membership card to the, here we go, Royal Air Force Club membership card. And that's my mum's membership card and her number, and then just a little tiny piece of tatting that I did for her years and years ago that she'd obviously kept. So that I wanted to keep, and I'm just going to put it on top of mum's picture in that little tuck in the back there. And see, I love that writing coming through the vellum there. I'm quite happy with that. And then if I just flip it over, I haven't done anything on the back other than I gave it a good clean, actually, which worked really well, just by using a normal pencil eraser or rubber. There was a Somerset House stamp on the bottom here, and just to add a little interest on there, I just covered it over with a torn piece of vellum and stitched round, and that's what gave me it's all falling apart now, the happy accident of having some stitching there which I wanted to cover up. And that's why I thought that I would just actually create just another little tuck spot. So it's a little, it fits, this card or this little piece of ephemera fits perfectly in there, but I decided I wanted to fit that one in as well. I don't really want to trim it down, but I just have to remember which order they go in. So there we go, everybody. That's my piece for week 36. I hope you like it. I'm really pleased how it turned out. It is just a very simple idea, but then the whole of the heirloom journal is really simple. The idea for that was to keep it pretty, and you can see my little bit of stitching along that border, although the rest of the running stitch is tucked away and hidden under there. So as always, everybody, thank you so much for letting me share this with you, and thank you more importantly for watching. I hope you enjoyed the piece, and Take care, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye-bye for now. Bye.